much. Thank you for the invitation in this very interesting conference. I will start immediately and to present my subject. This presentation concerns my previous post as the principal, as the head teacher of this school, of the 67th Primary School of Thessaloniki, which is located in a poor, underprivileged neighborhood of Xirokrini, part of which has known as the Rezi Vardar before the Second World War. Thessaloniki, also known as Salonika in Greece, housed a major Jewish community, mostly Sephardim, until the middle of the Second World War. It is the only known example of a city in this size in the Jewish diaspora that retained a Jewish majority for five centuries. Sephardic Jews immigrated to the city following their expulsion from Spain by Christian rulers under the Alhambra decree in 1492. This community influenced the Sephardic world both culturally and economically, and the city was nicknamed La Madre de Israel, Mother of Israel. During World War II, at dawn of April 9, 1941, Thessaloniki surrendered to the German occupation. A bit later, the Germans started to systematically persecute the Jews as they had in the other parts of Europe. In 1943, forced the Jews in Thessaloniki into a ghetto near the rail lines and started deporting them to Auschwitz, where most of the 50,000 deported died. About 37,000 of them were gassed immediately, especially women, children, and the elderly. At the end of the war, more than 19% of the total Jewish population of the city were murdered, and this resulted in the near extermination of the community. Only 1,200 Jews live in the city today. Here's the cemetery of Thessaloniki, who was destroyed during the Nazi German occupation. Thus, one of the world's largest Jewish cemeteries disappeared into the streets, sidewalks, and churches of the city. But how does all this relate to a teaching proposal and public school archives? In 2011, I was appointed as the new principal and new head teacher of the 67th primary school. In the summer of 2012, in order to gather all the available school files, I came upon the previous archival records of the school, which were well kept in a metal locker. To my great surprise, I discovered that it concerned of our pre-war school archive. I was astounded as an entire bygone world became vivid as I went through the names of the pupils, their places of origin, the profession of their fathers, their social background, etc. Most of them have suffered poverty and great misfortune. A considerable number of the children were orphans or had been abandoned. It was also fascinating to find out how little things have changed in this neighborhood, which continues to host people from mainly underprivileged backgrounds. But allow me to introduce you to the school neighborhood now. This neighborhood mainly housed poor Jews whose homes has been damaged by the great fire in Thessaloniki of 1917. They were transferred to this Rezi Vardar district, named after the nearby tobacco factory owned by the Rezi company. Since Some years later, Greek Christian refugees from Constantinople, now Istanbul, Thrace, Pontus, and Asia Minor, after the war and the population exchange between Greece and Turkey, formed the nearby Xirokrini, literally dry fountain district, which was closer to the railway lines. Here is the Xirokrini, the fountain of this neighborhood. And this place was the spot where, after the war, the new railway station of Thessaloniki will be built. In a guide of 1933 about Thessaloniki, we can learn that the settlement includes the old 1917 barracks housing the Jewish victims of the Great Fire, called the Teneke Mahala, built out of tin, that means. A great number of 6,000 people resided in this settlement, 400 natives, 4,000 refugees from Thrace and Asia Minor, and 2,000 Jewish victims of this great fire. It seems that Thessaloniki was intent on dumping all these poor homeless souls, refugees and Jews alike, in this neighborhood. Today, 67 primary schools were founded in June 1955, almost simultaneously with the construction of this prison building, the oldest building in this neighborhood, in the center of the district. It is essential till now a multicultural school hosting 200 pupils, descendants of those refugees, but also immigrant children from Albania and the former Soviet Union who have arrived in the region since the mid-90s. But the older school was housed elsewhere. The archives and the testimonies of local residents confirmed that it was a poor building of only three classrooms that hosted up to 400 pupils. In the 1930s, school staff included six teachers. One of these teachers, we will delve into names. Dimitrios Goulis was a graduate from the Fanar Greek Orthodox College in Constantinople, now Istanbul, meaning that himself was a refugee. According to the oral testimony of his granddaughter, he hired a British pilot for a long period during the Nazi occupation. According to records, Evangelos Antoniadis was a politicized teacher who often criticized books sent by the ministry to teach Greek language. Indeed, in 1938, during the dictatorship of Ioannis Metaxas, Antoniadis was arrested as a communist. After all, a little later in the archive, the school teachers denied that they had anything to do with the illegal Communist Party of Greece. The school archive state that on January 31, 1944, the teachers were forced to take the difficult decision to halt the operation of the school as two of their three classrooms were occupied by the Germans. In addition to hunger, malaria and tuberculosis threatened the lives of the pupils and teachers. In June 1944, the teachers raised funds in support of 32 children from the school who were suffering from tuberculosis and were hospitalized in the sanatorium of Thessaloniki. Accordingly, the seventh Jewish school of Rezi Vardar were located in a building that was used after the war as a public primary school. According to the archives of Jewish community of Thessalonica, the school was comprised of eight classes with 400 students. Abraham or Alberto Atas, who was the head teacher, the principal of the school, was born in 1884 and died in Auschwitz in 1943. Atas dedicated himself to social work. In 1925, he proposed the founding of the Malmai Sharumim Association, that means dressing the poor, to help the orphans and the other underprivileged Jewish students of his school. The archives of the Jewish community confirms that the school head teacher, four of its teachers and two members of the staff died in Auschwitz. The Jewish population of the neighborhood was deported on death trains to Auschwitz from 17 to 27 March 1943. Right after their departure, the settlement was looted, demolished, and any remaining houses grabbed by the non-Jewish population in an attempt to wipe out the area's Jewish past, condemned it to oblivion. However, the school Jewish identity remained intact in the memory of most locals until its demolition in the 1970s. Looking back, the archives of the school were impressed by the fact that for a period of 6 years, 100 Jewish students attended it. The reason why their families sent their children to the Christian public school are unclear. One possibility is that the Jewish families in the main porters and tobacco workers had decided to follow the example of a Jewish teacher, Gabriel Amar, who in 1927 sent his own children, Rachel and Jacob, to this Christian public school. The archives may contain clues as to Amar's personality and political ideas. In 1923, he was one of the founders of the Association of Fire Victims of Vardar. Its statute states that in the event of the dissolution of the association, half of its property will go to the communist newspaper Avanti, the Jewish communist newspaper Avanti. Indeed, our research has highlighted the class awareness of the region's tobacco workers and their initiation in the socialist ideology, as well as the strong ties that the Communist Party of Greece had developed with the poor Jews of the area. Our research made us realize that the archives represented an invaluable raw material of information, memories, and incidents that under certain conditions could become a fundamental part of a specific teaching program. The archival material of a school is ideal for use in new teaching programs because it fulfills as the prerequisites for a modern approach to the teaching of local history in school. More specifically, we have identified three benefits for learning microhistory through school archives. Firstly, it offers students the opportunity to deal with hidden or neglected aspects of history with the aim of achieving a historical understanding of events at the macrosocial level, and most importantly, at the microsocial level. Secondly, it changes the educational progress from that of traditional text-centered one to an exploratory, collaborative one, placing all students as active subjects of the cognitive process. As a result, the dominance of simple historical information is reduced, while the gradual familiarization with the parameters of the school research and its scientific methodology in general is given weight. Under these circumstances, the historical approach to a place concludes in the constitution of the cognitive historical material. Thirdly, in any case, local history brings us closer to a person through the activities, the feelings exhibited, the motives, and the choices that are part of a personality in a specific time and place. The fact that one of the most arduous parts of the historical approach by researchers and scholars in general concerns not only the way that the teacher conveys historical knowledge to pupils, and in turn, the way the pupils receive and filter this historical material, but the delving into the psychological profile of the persons involved in a certain historical moment. For that reason, local history is an excellent tool. This research resulted in two teacher proposals. The first concerned the absence of the neighborhood's Jewish identity, and the second, its refugee past. The first teaching proposal was given as the title, Discovering the Past of My Neighborhood by Walking in the Streets and Researching the School Archives. It was implemented by 6th graders about 12 years old in 2014-2015. The learning resources used was the follows. The pupils registered in the archives of the school, all photos of the neighborhoods, web pages with text and photographic material, tables and graphical representations, books of the modern history about the history of Thessaloniki. The pupils worked together to collect their research data from the school archives and to reach their conclusions. A similar procedure was followed by the children, in presenting their work at the event addressed to parents and the local community. Here is the implementation. The educational program proceeded as follows. We conducted an initial discussion with the pupils concerning the project and all the historical and research questions it gave rise to, such as who lived in our neighborhood years ago, how and when did they come here, how did our region look years ago, what the similarities and the differences between the people then and now, how was life for the pupils in the old school, and where was the building located? Our next step was to show a short film entitled A Stellar Journey to the Past that we produced it in our school during 2012 school year. The film was also known during the school film festival here in Thessaloniki in May 2012. In this film, the pupils of today travel back in time to 50 years ago and have the chance to get to know the students of the old school. It was actually a science fiction short film. Later we embarked our first historical work in the pupils' neighborhood. At the same time, walking on the streets, we made an attempt to reconstitute the urban landscape of the past by holding historical pictures in our hands, making comparison and discussing the changes that took place over time. Finally, our walking tour ended at the Jewish Museum of Thessaloniki. There, the curator of the museum, Evangelos Hekimoglou, informed the pupils about the topography of Xirokrini from the 18th to early 20th centuries. Through comparisons of maps and photographic sources, students had the chance, in addition to acquiring knowledge, to discuss the issue of the reliability of the sources and come up with conclusions about the neighborhood. It is worth noting that during this visit in a Jewish museum, there was no prior reference as to the purpose of the exhibit of the museum, which was a deliberate decision in order to motivate their curiosity in a more spontaneous way, because the pupils start to pose some questions about the museum. After this, the school archives from 1926 to 1934 was presented to the pupils. They were divided into groups. Each group assumed a distinct field of information, such as the place of origin, parents' occupation, religions, etc. Spreadsheets were created with the students' names. The pupils then came up with information concerning the presence of Jewish students. The group presented their work regarding the places of origin and parents' occupation of the 1920s, 1930s pupils. They combined information from the school sources with broader historical events. Why were so many orphans? Because of the war and the topography of the area. Why were there so many tobacco workers? Because there is the Rezi tobacco factory. An initial conversation about the loss of Jewish pupils in the Holocaust commenced. We continued with the discussion of the Jewish presence in the city. The pupils were there presented with information of the deportation of the Jews to Auschwitz during World War II. For another time, we took a new walking tour of a specific location in attempt to reconstitute the urban landscape of the past and to discern any changes that had happened over time and history. Our last stop was again the Jewish Museum of Thessaloniki. There, the person who was in charge of the museum's educational program divided the students into groups, engaging them in a series of activities related to the history of Jewish presence in Thessalonica from the antiquity to modern times. Afterwards, they focused on specific museum objects and presented the results of their work to the museum. The deal between the school and the museum was simple. You teach me the general history of Jewish community, I will present you my research on my neighborhood. At a special event commemorating the sixth anniversary of the 67th primary school, the pupils presented the result of their research to their parents and other residents in attendance. Topics covered included the history of the neighborhood and the refugees and Jews who lived in it, their occupation and their daily lives, the Nazi wartime occupation and the dark chapter of the Holocaust in this neighborhood, and the narratives of former teachers and pupils. But there is another second teaching proposal concerning, firstly, the refugee children of the after the war between Greece and Turkey. The title was The Narration of the Absent, Creative Reconstruction of the Neighborhood Past Through the Archives Material of the School. Through the role of the historian researcher, the students of the sixth range next school year approach the past, which is highlighted by archival material, place, time, people, and their activities, and capture the trace of his interpretation with narratives that I attempt to reconstitute by giving a voice to this absence. The creativity of the narrative is expressed through choices which conserve both the content of the text and the type, form, quality, and extent of the interactions, which are structured in relation to the archival material. The narrative material produced, which can be used as an alternative side-by-side activity for teaching local history in primary and secondary education, contributes to the development of narrative literacy and indirectly to the cultivation of historical literacy, since according to the postmodern historiographical view, the historical time is identified with the time of the narration. Students' narratives transform their neighborhood past from a narrative object to an another subject, combining historical archival research with creative writing. The evaluation of Roland resulted from observation and discussion with the students and the people of this neighborhood. A most interesting development was the parents and residents of the area endorsed the participation of their children in the program, expressing the view that they had the chance to acquire valuable information regarding local history information that they themselves were unaware of. Additionally, a considerable amount of the residents well contribute to the research program with photographic material and personal narrations that were intensely moving. Finally, the pupils through this project were able to redefine their attitude not only towards the historical events connected to the microhistory of their those neighborhood, but also towards the way they were able to approach them as the researchers. To conclude, their involvement in the project and the vast amount of knowledge they acquired successfully generated empathy for the rich multicultural profile that characterizes their neighborhood. And most important of all, the students themselves raised the Jewish past of the neighborhood from of oblivion. Finally, from my new position as a professor in the School of Film in Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, as a part of the course Cinema, Television and Holocaust, we are already preparing it with my students a documentary film on this subject. And for me, all this project was and it continues to be a small tribute to the memories of those who were absent from this neighborhood, all those who disappeared in this dark spring of 1943. Thank you for your attention.